Long before Kurt Russell was growing badass mustaches and playing sexy Santa Claus, back before John Carpenter was a live concert performer and otherwise a hermit who mostly sat in his room and played video games, these two figures created some of the greatest films in horror history. So, how did this unusual, delightful, and fruitful relationship come about? Let's find out on today's episode of Deadly Duos. The year is 1978. John already has a few other films under his belt. His student film project turned theatrical release Dark Star and the exploitation remake of Rio Bravo, Assault on Precinct 13. Carpenter was eager to keep working, and the same year that he made Halloween, he sold screenplays for the theatrical release Eyes of Laura Mars and the TV movie Zuma Beach. He even wrote and directed an entire other horror thriller the same year with 1978's Someone's Watching Me, starring Lauren Hutton and Carpenter's frequent collaborator and soon-to-be wife, Adrienne Barbeau. He didn't know Halloween was going to be a huge hit, and he just wanted to work, so he went where the work was. And boy, was there some work in TV movies in the 1970s. Modern-day TV movies are now mostly basic cable thrillers from Lifetime based on true stories about cops who murder their wives. But in the 1970s, there was a creative boom. Dan Curtis's Dead of Night, Satan's School for Girls, the delightfully weird Bad Ronald, and the original Don't Be Afraid of the Dark were all movies made for TV in that era, and Carpenter knew it was a cash cow waiting to be milked. And after the 1-2 horror punch of Halloween and Someone's Watching Me, Carpenter was ready to stretch himself and try something epic and dramatic. That thing ended up being 1979's 3-hour biopic, Elvis. It would be a 30-day shoot with over 150 locations, and Carpenter would not remember it fondly as a filmmaking experience. But one great thing came from it. By the time Kurt Russell appeared in his first Disney movie, Follow Me Boys, at age 15, he'd already been acting for 4 years, and he'd been a regular on a TV series. For nearly a decade, from 1966 to 1975, Russell had a flourishing career with Disney, making 9 movies and a handful of TV episodes. But at 24, he was a little long in the tooth for a Disney teen actor. In 1975, the same year he made his last Disney film, The Strongest Man in the World, Russell played real-life notorious sniper killer Charles Whitman in the TV movie The Deadly Tower. That helped to shift the audience's perception of him, and he continued the transformation into grown-up star. Then came John Carpenter and the Elvis movie. He was a perfect fit. He looked a bit like young Elvis, he was a talented young actor who still had years of experience in the business, and there was even a connection to Elvis himself. At 12 years old, Russell appeared in the Elvis Presley movie It Happened at the World's Fair as a kid who kicked Elvis on screen. The stars had aligned, and Russell and Carpenter worked together on the film, which was a moderate success and garnered an Emmy nomination for Russell's performance. Whether it was the bad experience of working on an epic drama or the draw of going back to the big screen, Carpenter followed up Elvis with The Fog, a throwback ghost story he made with his now wife, Adrienne Barbeau. The film was a commercial success, but got middling critical reviews at the time. It was later reevaluated as an early classic in his body of work, a recurring indignity that Carpenter suffered through for most of his career. Russell, meanwhile, continued the shift away from his Disney persona with Used Cars, a pitch-black comedy from a young Robert Zemeckis. It's now a beloved cult comedy, and it did well theatrically, but it still wasn't the iconic break from his former persona that Russell was seeking. That all changed with Carpenter's next project. Escape from New York was a dystopian thriller and a darkly straight-faced satire, and the central role of Snake Plissken was written as the uber anti-hero. If Dirty Harry and the Man with No Name were even less kind and cuddly, you'd have Snake Plissken. For Carpenter, casting a beloved Disney star as the eyepatch-wearing criminal protagonist just added to the dark satire, and for Russell, this was exactly the kind of role that would distance him from his previous work. The film was also something of a family affair, with Barbeau in a co-starring role, and Russell's then-wife, Susan Hubley, who he actually met while shooting Elvis, making a cameo appearance. The movie was a critical and commercial success, earning $25 million at the box office. Snake Plissken quickly became an iconic movie character, with memorable lines delivered at barely above a whisper, poking even more fun at the Clint Eastwood-esque character that they were satirizing. The duo was a bona fide hit, and they enjoyed working together so much that they went straight into production on another film together. That next movie is The Stuff of Legend, a remake of the 1951 classic The Thing from Another World. Carpenter and Russell teamed up with special effects artist Rob Bottin to bring a terrifying, one-of-a-kind experience to screen with The Thing. Russell once again ran away from his traditional persona, playing a wild bearded helicopter pilot working at an Antarctic research base where a thawed out alien starts picking off crew members one by one and taking their form. The movie made its budget back, but just barely. However, to say that the movie was poorly received would be kind. Critics panned the film for its deep cynicism and the graphic nature of its practical effects, something that hadn't been seen to that degree on the big screen in a major release. The movie eventually gained its well-deserved status as one of the great science fiction horror films of all time, but it wouldn't be for years, and certainly not soon enough to help Carpenter's career recovery. While Russell went straight into acting in back-to-back Oscar-nominated films Silkwood and Swing Shift, Carpenter's journey would be a little bumpier, knowing he would need a sure thing under his belt after the critical attacks and middling performance of The Thing. He signed on to direct Christine, an adaptation of a new Stephen King book. As long as he didn't screw anything up, a King movie was a virtual lock for theatrical success. It was a financial decision rather than a creative one for Carpenter, but the movie made back twice its budget and helped to put him back on safer ground career-wise. His next task was to make a film that showed audiences and critics his sensitive side, to shut down accusations that his work was cynical and cruel. The next film was Starman, a sweetly romantic science fiction road movie. It was similar in tone to E.T., the film that was released a week before The Thing, and which many blamed for the unfavorable comparison in critical write-ups. Starman made back its budget, but it was also nominated for an Oscar for Jeff Bridges' brilliant central performance. Once again, Carpenter was being taken seriously as a director. He and Russell, both coming off award-nominated films, decided to team back up for another project, one that was destined to convince audiences of the bankability of their work, right? What in the hell were they thinking? Of course, Big Trouble in Little China is delightful and brilliant. It is a madcap, East meets West, supernatural, martial arts buddy comedy that is also somehow a parody of all those things at the same time. Carpenter cast Russell in the lead role, and they decided that since they'd already mocked the Eastwood persona in Escape from New York, it was time to take on the Duke. Russell's John Wayne-style performance as a faux manly blowhard whose soft-spoken friend is the real badass is a hilarious takedown of masculine action tropes. He must have known this was a massive risk, especially with a price tag of $25 million. But Carpenter is nothing if not an iconoclast, and he made the movie he wanted, and that movie made $11 million. Carpenter's rise from the ashes of failure on The Thing to commercial and critical success with his last two movies went into a free fall once again. Perhaps the duo needed a break. Maybe they were having so much fun together that they weren't taking the bigger picture into consideration. Who knows what led them to the decision, but the next decade gave us no Carpenter-Russell films. They remained good friends, but made no movies together. In the interim, Russell became a legitimate action movie star in films like Executive Decision, Backdraft, and Stargate. He was Wyatt Earp in the classic Tombstone, and he even played the voice of Elvis for his director friend Robert Zemeckis in Forrest Gump. I mean, what's with this guy in Elvis, right? He even played an Elvis impersonator in the 2001 film 3,000 Miles to Graceland. Meanwhile, Carpenter was tired of the mainstream for a bit. He signed on to a two-picture deal for low-budget films where he could retain creative control. Out of that came a couple of his most memorable films, Prince of Darkness and the beloved They Live. He had one more swing at a big-budget studio film with Memoirs of an Invisible Man, and another remake of a classic science fiction film with Village of the Damned. By then, Carpenter was exhausted of the industry and the town that fueled it. He didn't like the studio system or the current cinema output, and he wanted to burn it all to the ground. He decided to do exactly that in his next movie, a sequel called Escape from LA. Reuniting with his friend Russell, who'd had his own struggles finding unique and challenging roles in a landscape of standard action and thriller fare, Carpenter co-wrote the script with Russell and longtime producing partner Deborah Hill, leaning away from the dark dystopia and more heavily into the satire. No sacred cow was left untouched, from American religious figures to plastic surgeons to the Universal Studios theme park. Carpenter and Russell were clearly having fun. The audience? Not as much. The movie cost $50 million, and it made about half of that back in its theatrical release. Though some critics appreciated its satirical elements, it was overall not well received. It has found something of a cult following in recent years, but still doesn't enjoy the appreciation of their earlier collaborations. But that poor reception will never be able to take away this one fact. When Kurt Russell came back to play Snake Plissken 15 years after the original, he was still able to fit perfectly into the original costume. How about a hand for Kurt Russell? He keeps it tight. So will that be the end of the line for this great deadly duo? Will they ever work together again? Well, Russell's star is on the rise again in a big way, appearing in everything from the Fast and Furious franchise to several of Quentin Tarantino's movies, and he's even been immortalized in a Marvel film with Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. He's clearly not done acting anytime soon. So the real question is not for him, but for Carpenter. What could possibly rouse him to step behind the camera and partner with his old friend one more time? Got any suggestions? We'd love to hear them. That's it for this episode of Deadly Duos. We'll see you again soon with more Scare Pairs.